Please welcome Director, Development Tools, AWS, Ken Exner, and Head of Community Engagement, AWS, Emily Freeman.
The ecosystem in which we work is the most complex environment in tech to date. There was a point in time when software development was a straight line. Sure, there were different challenges. Debuggers, for example, didn't exist when Margaret Hamilton wrote the code that put humans on the moon. She just had to be right, almost perfect, really. But the path to software delivery, while perhaps a little bit more difficult, was fairly straightforward. There were software requirements, which were written into code, and that code created the software, and that software was deployed onto mainframes via punch cards or mag tape. Or, in the case of Margaret Hamilton, loaded onto two onboard computers containing 32,000 bits of RAM. Or put another way, less than 1% of 1 megabyte of RAM.
And then it just was. I mean, think about a world where your security effort can be summarized by remembering to lock the door. That sounds nice, downright pleasant. But the world in which we write and deploy code is, well, worlds away. The compute power at our fingertips was unimaginable in the early days of NASA. In fact, it's increased by over 1 trillion-fold. With a T. But with power comes chaos. The systems that we develop and maintain contain dozens of applications made up of hundreds of services distributed across infrastructure across the world to be geographically closer to our customers.
All right, hey, Emily, before you open Pandora's box, maybe we should introduce ourselves?
That's probably a good idea.
Yeah, all right. Hi, I'm Ken Exner, Director of AWS Developer Tools. I'm really passionate about developer productivity, and I look after the tools and services in AWS that help you build on AWS.
Ken's being modest. He oversees SDKs, command line tools, languages and runtimes, IDEs, infrastructure as code tools, DevOps tools, and mobile and front-end development. So, a lot. And I'm Emily Freeman. I'm the author of DevOps for Dummies and the curator of 97 Things Every Cloud Engineer Should Know. I think about all things developers, community, and storytelling at AWS. OK, now can I open Pandora's box?
Open her up.
Thank you. Yep. You know the complexity that I'm speaking about firsthand in your everyday work. I mean, in the early days of software, there was assembly and Fortran and COBOL. Now there are over 700 languages.
Yeah, there's JavaScript and TypeScript, there's Python, there's SQL and Go and C Sharp.
Oh, Rust.
Oh, yeah, we love Rust. And there's Kotlin and there's C and C++ and Ruby
okay.
And Perl and PHP. And,
oh my gosh, yeah. okay, yeah. Enough. They have to rate us, they're scaring them.
Yeah, no, but that's just languages. We haven't even gotten to the tooling part.
Oh, Lord.
For example, let's just look at the JavaScript ecosystem.
Okay. You mean like Node?
Sure, like Node. Like Node is the JavaScript runtime environment that helps you execute JavaScript outside the browser. It's important, but there's really hundreds more. Babel, for example, compiles JavaScript in the older browsers and older environments. And then there's module bundlers and task runners like Webpack and Parcel and Gulp and Grunt. NPM is the default package manager in the largest software registry in the world, containing over like 1 million packages.
Wait, I thought we were good at packages.
Oh yeah, we are. But then there are frameworks, modules, and libraries like Express, and Socket.io, and Async, and RxJS, and Lodash, and Yup.
Yup.
No, I mean Yup, the schema builder.
Oh, I knew that.
Yeah. And then there's Bower, and Yarn, and then there's collections of tooling like Jamstack, and Mean, and Mern.
Mern?
Yeah, don't look at me.
Who comes up with these? People make fun of our service names.
Yeah, and then you have Angular, and you have React, and you have Vue, and you have Svelte, and Ember and Polymer and Stencil and Crank and Gatsby and Scully and Gridsum and Next.
Nuxt?
No, Next.
Yeah, and then Nuxt.
Naming is hard. There's GraphQL, and there's WebSockets and React Native and Cordova and Electron and...
Okay, this is just too much. I need to sit down.
No,
no, anyone have a chair?
But we haven't even gotten to testing and authentication and sessions and scaling and message queues and local storage and hosting and other utilities. And that's just JavaScript. So let me ask you, Emily, are you overwhelmed yet?
Okay, let me put it this way. If I were a Victorian, I would need smelling salts.
Well, anyway, so that's just the JavaScript community. Let's look next at the Kubernetes ecosystem. The Cloud Native Computing Foundation, or the CNCF, put together a cloud native landscape that depicts all the tooling options that are available in the Kubernetes ecosystem. I think this one diagram captures the sheer magnitude of this problem.
Yeah.
The overwhelming number of options available to developers today, and the number of decisions that developers need to make every single day.
You're right. I think it's one of the reasons so many of us struggle with burnout. It's decision fatigue. There's just so much to think about. I mean, the days of a Java monolith and a single executable SQL database deployed on premises are, well, they're gone. But I think there's a way of reframing this rather intimidating, scary slide. Yes, there are an overwhelming number of tools available to us as engineers. But although we do have to decide which tools to use, we don't have to actually build the functionality they offer by hand. And that's an abstraction. Now, we talk a lot about abstractions as engineers. Abstractions are really a way of accelerating developer productivity. What we usually mean is that we're obfuscating logic or creating a separation of concerns by removing overhead from an engineer. This is because computer scientists have long used the word for meaning removing certain details in order to focus on broader concepts. Especially over the last few years with the surge of cloud adoption, I think abstraction has become one of these tech buzzwords that we use all the time, but we never clearly define. Now, if you know me, you know that I love to find nuggets of truth in other industries and apply them to our work. I am the daughter of two fine artists, and in visual art, abstraction is selecting elements from an object and reducing it to its most basic lines, shapes, or textures. Picasso was one of these incredible artists, rare, really. He was capable of classical painting techniques, but due to his extreme talent, was utterly bored with the old way of doing things. He eschewed realism and classic perspective for abstract renderings and cubism. His series of 11 lithographs called The Bull convey a step-by-step reduction of an image depicting a realistic bull to one that illustrates the most basic form of the animal, roughly 10 lines. A true master, Picasso stripped the bull of every unnecessary detail while retaining the essence of the animal. It is one of the most stunning visual demonstrations of an abstraction in the world. But abstractions exist outside of art museums as well, on the very streets we walk. The reason we no longer build buildings with ornate facades like Versailles is due to the modernist movement. In the late 19th and 20th centuries, architects began to buck traditional aesthetics. Designers focused on the materials from which a building was constructed and basic geometric shapes. Frank Lloyd Wright was a pioneer of modern architects, and in all his works, you'll see a focus on shape and form. But here's the important part. While these structures are abstractions of their more traditional, more ornate forms, they are still very clearly buildings. And Picasso's bull figure is still very much a bull. The abstraction didn't change the object. Instead, it simplified it so that it could be observed and consumed in a different way. And in this distilled form, it is more purely itself. And somehow, in that clean simplicity, it more boldly declares itself. Abstractions are useful not because they distract or ignore data, but instead home in on the important bits. I believe abstractions are our modernist movement. We've developed ways to see the essence of our socio-technical systems. Abstractions purposefully remove detail, but it doesn't mean that that detail isn't important.
Barbara Lizkoff captured this in a quote from Programming with Abstract Data Types. She said, "What we desire from an abstraction is a mechanism which permits the expression of relevant details and the suppression of irrelevant details." Abstractions are fundamental to software development and have been since, well, forever. In object-oriented programming, an object is an abstraction. In functional programming, a higher-order function is an abstraction. Data types are an abstraction of data structures. A procedure or a subroutine abstracts control flow. But it goes even deeper than that. Operating systems, for example, abstract hardware so well that you don't have to think about it anymore. You don't have to think about resource management when you keep 983 tabs open in your browser and try to code at the same time.
No one in this room does that at all, no.
You simply don't have to consider physical memory anymore. The operating system abstracts functionality so that you can focus on your work and you don't have to think about the specific hardware requirements of your machine. That is the power of an abstraction. This is seen in languages too. Low-level languages are machine-oriented. Code is built to the specifications of the processor on which it's going to be run. Middle-level languages like C are a bit more flexible because they compile down to assembly, but programmers still have to manage memory manually. And then came increasingly higher-level languages. Lisp, for example, was the first to introduce garbage collection, which is a way of automating memory management. In most modern languages, developers don't have to think about allocating or managing memory anymore. This, in and of itself, is an extremely useful abstraction. Preventing and debugging memory leaks used to be a significant task. In fact, developers used to spend something like 20 or 30% of their time just managing memory. Garbage collection was a huge step forward, allowing developers to focus on solving the challenges of their unique application and not on having to do memory management. But problems still remained. One of the problems garbage collection has is that it initiates a stop-the-world pause, meaning the developers have to optimize their applications to deal with these breaks. So to compensate for this, developers often over-provision their compute resources, or they have to spend a lot of time tuning the garbage collector. Well, that all stops today. We're happy to announce improvements on the Credo 17 branch of OpenJDK. Credo is the Amazon open source distribution of OpenJDK, and it includes a new version of the Shenandoah garbage collector available in preview. I invite everyone to try it out and give us feedback. We believe it is the next step forward in garbage collection for the JVM, or the Java virtual machine, impacting languages such as Java, Kotlin, Clojure, and Scala. This release adds generational collection to the Shenandoah garbage collector, improving throughput and memory utilization. This makes generational Shenandoah the first of its kind, an open source, concurrent, generational garbage collector for the JVM.
You're probably wondering how we got here. Okay, not really. But when I first heard that phrase, generational concurrent garbage collector, I kind of shrugged and went like, well, that's cool. But I didn't really know what it meant. And I think it's worth a really quick review of how memory management and garbage collection works so that we can understand just how big of a deal this is. When you execute code to create a variable, there are two places in which objects can be created, both in RAM or random access memory. The first is the stack. This group has limited scope and stores temporary variables. When the code is finished running, the stack automatically clears and everything is erased. This is because the allocation and deallocation of memory is done for you by the compiler. I like to think of the stack as a waiting room. It's a place for the program to acknowledge a thing exists while it figures out what to do with it. But the waiting room is small, tiny even, and memory is limited. If you try and create too many objects, you'll eventually get a stack overflow. The heap, on the other hand, stores global variables, And memory is not automatically deallocated because a global variable will never go out of scope. The heap, to me, is the everything drawer of your application. It's large, memory is allocated randomly, and everything is just sort of shoved in. You know, a little bit like that litany of unorganized extra batteries and cords that you shove into that random drawer in your kitchen or office. No? Just me? Okay. The heap is pretty big, but you can still run out of memory. And in lower level languages, you must delete global variables manually, or you'll create a memory leak, which is essentially a degradation of performance due to fragmented RAM. That requirement and the fact that humans are a bit forgetful, or frankly terrible, at remembering to do repetitive tasks is why garbage collection is so important. But here's the tricky part. The program can't just willy-nilly delete everything because you still need things. It would be a little bit like hiring someone to organize your closet, and instead of buying fancy boxes and cute hangers, they just donated everything you owned. And while an empty closet is technically organized, it's not exactly helpful. You still need clothes to get dressed in. The garbage collector determines which parts of memory are still in use. This is a really big deal, but it doesn't stop there.
Garbage collection is an incredible developer tool, but there are still a few significant challenges. The most significant being that it has to pause the application while it sorts out what can and cannot be thrown away.
Oh, Ken, what did the one garbage collector say to the other garbage collector?
What?
Long pause. Get it? It's so bad, it's good.
All right. Garbage collectors have to traverse the entire object graph to find out which pieces of memory are in use and which can be reallocated. In a mark and sweep approach, reachable or referenced objects are marked. This marking requires a stop the world pause because application threads could interfere with the process. Sweeping then takes place after marking and essentially sweeps all the memory that is unreachable or memory that cannot be referred to. If we left the heap in this state, it might be okay, but it might not be okay. If a really large object needed to take up a lot of space or multiple blocks, you might still get an out-of-memory error, which is why we compact the memory, moving all the objects and references. Now, the downside to doing this, though, is that it increases the time that the application is paused. Now, Shenandoah improved on this by introducing concurrent evacuation and update references, using concurrent copy and concurrent compaction approaches. But this is where the generational approach to garbage collection enters the story. Generational garbage collection is a technique used to reduce GC pause times. It works by splitting the heap into two generations and assumes that most objects will die young. This is actually called the generational hypothesis, which simply states that in most cases, young objects are more likely to die than old objects. Therefore, most of the time the garbage collector runs, it marks and sweeps the young generation only. Generational Shenandoah identifies the areas that contain new objects from objects that already survived at least one garbage collection sweep. So with this new garbage collector, the heap regions then are designated as free, young, or old. Now, the primary improvement of generational Shenandoah is that it has increased efficiency. Because the collector can focus on the areas that contain the most garbage, it lowers pause times, shortens collection cycles, and reduces the amount of memory needed to achieve low pause times.
That's incredible.
All right, so unlike the JVM, Rust doesn't have garbage collection, making it about as performant as C, the most performant programming language available to us. Yet C has one fairly significant flaw. It's memory unsafe, meaning that it's vulnerable to multiple bugs related to memory access. This is where Java, although a little bit slower than C, improved on C. It created runtime error detection to avoid dangling pointers and other common vulnerabilities. Rust, however, takes a different approach. The Rust type system detects attempts to use freed memory and prevents them at compile time. In fact, the same type system also prevents data races, which is one of the most common bugs we see in parallel programming. Rust's combination of efficiency and safety have quickly made it critical to building infrastructure at AWS. And AWS is investing in the future of Rust and is excited about contributing to the sustainability of the Rust project and community. In 2019, AWS joined other industry leaders in sponsoring the Rust project. In 2020, AWS made investments in the future of the language by hiring maintainers and contributors. In 2021, AWS became a founding sponsor of the Rust Foundation, an open source, an independent nonprofit supporting the Rust project. Recently, the Rust Foundation announced the Cloud Compute Program, which provides free compute to Rust maintainers on AWS, Azure, and Google Cloud. We think that the power of AWS Compute enables contributors to move faster so they can commit code in a fraction of the time. Internally at AWS, Rust is used in services such as Amazon S3, EC2, CloudFront, and many more. Rust guarantees memory safety through its type system, which is built on this concept of ownership and borrowing. In Rust, every piece of data has an owner. When a function returns, the compiler knows which data it owns, therefore eliminating the need for garbage collection.
Pretty incredible. Parallel programming has a reputation of being difficult and dangerous. This is because it can be hard to know when threads are accessing data at the same time. In Rust, the type system prevents data races. This is what Rust programmers talk about when they say fearless concurrency. I think that's pretty awesome. Rust delivers a powerful combination of efficiency and safety that makes it possible for engineers to build better and faster. AWS customers who have converted code from Node to Rust report massive speedups and dramatic reductions in memory usage, as much as 75% faster and utilizing 95% less memory. This translates to lower costs for everyone. Abstractions come in a lot of different forms and often take a pretty opinionated approach to simplifying development. In the case of Rust, the unwavering use of ownership enables the language to remove decades-old limitations of performant programming languages. I am really excited about the abstractions that AWS is creating to help developers eliminate unnecessary complexity and accelerate their productivity, so that they can focus on what they do best, solve problems. I think AWS excels at eliminating the undifferentiated heavy lifting that slows developers down. And we build these abstractions in ways that enable developers to work in the way that they've always worked, in languages and patterns of development with which they're already familiar.
One of the ways we do this most directly in AWS is with our SDKs. These language-specific SDKs simplify the use of AWS services by providing consistent and familiar libraries for developers. SDKs implement best practices, but they also take care of all the messy details in calling a web service, things like retry logic and authentication and signing and serializing and deserializing data and support for various protocols. But perhaps more importantly, these SDKs provide an idiomatic development experience, making it possible for our customers to use the APIs in the languages of their choice. Now, over the years, we've developed 13 SDKs supporting various language communities. But this morning, in Werner's keynote, we announced three new SDKs in developer preview: Kotlin, Rust, and Swift, to add to our existing portfolio. Kotlin is an open source language that targets the JVM and is built to be interoperable with Java. Kotlin aims to balance concise code with human-readable code. Now, the SDK for Kotlin mimics the language features, like domain-specific language or DSL builders. And unlike threading, callbacks, features, promises, and things like that, Kotlin takes a different approach to async programming, called coroutines. The SDK for Kotlin executes suspendable functions that run efficiently in coroutines. Along with Kotlin, we also introduced an SDK for Rust. This developer preview supports over 280 services. By the way, I want to acknowledge and thank the contributors to the Risotto open source project who led the way here and created the first AWS libraries in Rust. The AWS SDK for Rust divides services into individual crates, thereby minimizing compile times. A crate in Rust is simply a compiled package. The SDK for Rust also integrates with Tokio, the asynchronous runtime in Rust. I'm excited to see how this functionality is extended over the next few years and to support the growth of the Rust community. Now, for over a decade, the AWS SDK for iOS existed to support mobile developers. But as the Swift community has grown, AWS recognized a need to support native Swift in our SDKs, in addition to support for Objective-C. So we're happy to announce the AWS SDK for Swift, which not only supports mobile development in Swift, but also server-side Swift. And again, I want to acknowledge and recognize the community contributions here. The Soto SDK and the AWS SDK, Smoke SDK, came prior to this and supported developers using Swift on AWS for many years, so thank you. Your feedback is important to this process. These are developer preview releases, and they're a first step, but we'll continue working on improvements and working on your feedback.
I think AWS SDKs are notable in that they all utilize the Smithy toolchain and service models. Now, I remember a few months ago, I sort of bounced over to you, and I was like, Ken, have you heard of Smithy? And you were like, you know, very calmly, because you're Ken Exner, you were like, yes, of course, I've heard of Smithy, Emily. And I was like, then why don't we talk about it all the time? Because I'm obsessed. Smithy was really born out of the AWS approach to developing services, which is model-first design. Will you tell us more about that?
Of course. As you know, AWS has the broadest and deepest portfolio of services, topping 280 services externally. But internally, there are thousands more. When you think about scaling, you typically think about scaling for individual load or additional load. But when you try to scale an entire socio-technical system, it's a much harder lift. You have to invent ways to move fast. You have to develop frameworks and models to communicate concepts across multiple teams and skill sets. You have to create standard tools and ensure that teams have self-service access to that centralized tooling. As AWS grew, engineers internally iterated through a number of different frameworks for how to scale APIs and build SDKs. AWS is model first in our approach to API design rather than code first. And we think this is consistent with the Amazon process of working backwards. In the Amazon process of working backwards, you start with the outcome, usually a customer experience, and then you work backwards from there to ensure that you're providing the best possible experience. In AWS, this means that we design the API first. An API, or an SDK, is really a contract between the service provider and the customer or user. And it's important that as we build out features, that backwards compatibility is maintained and that contract is honored, and that breaking changes are not introduced. For example, over the years, we have completely rebuilt the back end of Amazon S3, but the original S3 APIs have remained intact because that is the contract. Now, Smithy is the tool that we use in AWS for how to design and build and review our APIs. We open sourced it in 2019 because we believe it's a framework that can be used by AWS customers and developers of all types. Smithy is an API modeling tool that allows you to think about, design, and discuss APIs and components without ever having to write a single line of code. It generates readable code that can be converted into other formats like OpenAPI. Anyway, if you want more detail, Michael Dowling, the co-creator of Smithy, gave a really great talk in October called Scaling APIs with Smithy, and he discusses the full origin story. Anyway, we love Smithy, and we hope you try it out when you're building out APIs and SDKs for your customers. Now, another way we've abstracted our web services is through our infrastructure as code tools, namely AWS CloudFormation and the AWS CDK, or the Cloud Development Kit. Now, since the CDK sits on top of CloudFormation and compiles down to CloudFormation that then provisions resources, I'm going to first begin with CloudFormation. AWS CloudFormation launched 10 years ago and helped pioneer the infrastructure as code space. Today, more than 1 million AWS customers use CloudFormation to manage their infrastructure. CloudFormation makes it possible to define infrastructure declaratively and to provision that infrastructure safely with features like rollback and drift detection. With CloudFormation, you can provision stacks or global stack sets based on templates. Templates simply define the desired state of your application, and they're comprised of resources. Resources are the base atomic unit of CloudFormation. Customers have long been able to define custom resources in CloudFormation for integrating non-AWS resources. But earlier this year, CloudFormation introduced CloudFormation Registry, offering native support for third-party resources. This includes resources published by our partners like MongoDB, Datadog, Atlassian, JFrog, Splunk, and many more. With CloudFormation Registry, all cloud-based resources can be managed together. For example, let's say an AWS customer utilizes Datadog to monitor an application. Historically, customers had to provision and manage their monitoring separate from the rest of the application. But Registry changes all of that. Now customers can provision and manage AWS and non-AWS resources all in one place. But I think the power of CloudFormation resources doesn't stop here. As an abstraction, CloudFormation resources extend AWS API models by mapping an operations-oriented API into a resource-oriented API. So instead of having to memorize hundreds of expressive APIs like launch instance and create bucket and attach volume, you can work with a resource-oriented interface based on a small set of consistent verbs. The power of this approach extends beyond CloudFormation and even beyond infrastructure as code, which is why we recently launched AWS Cloud Control API, which is a new consistent control plane for AWS and beyond. We've taken all the resources in the CloudFormation registry, both first-party and third-party, and given them a consistent CRUDL interface for create, read, update, delete, and list. We realized that CloudFormation resources essentially provided a way of expressing web service functionality through a resource-oriented object. This meant that we could take every AWS resource, and in fact, every resource in the CloudFormation registry, and make it accessible via the same CRUDL-based interface. Fully realized, this means that every resource in the cloud can have the same consistent API. Imagine that. One API, one consistent API for everything. Well, our partners like HashiCorp and Pulumi recognized the power of this concept early and have begun adding support to tools like Terraform to support Cloud Control API for their resources and for their providers to leverage this new consistent API. This way, they always stay up to date with AWS and every cloud vendor in the registry because every service has the same API. This consistent API also improved our ability to support IDEs internally. Recently, we launched support for 200 new resource types across 94 services in the AWS toolkits. And this was made possible by this consistent API that is in the Cloud Control API. All right, let's now have another look at another abstraction, the CDK. The AWS CDK is an open source software development framework for defining your cloud infrastructure using programming languages that you are already familiar with. And yes, you heard right, it's open sourced.
It's incredible. To better understand the power of CDK, it's important to step back for a moment and discuss the two approaches to provisioning resources. The first is imperatively. In this approach, developers define steps needed to reach a particular goal. The second is declaratively, which is where a developer instead asserts the desired state of a system. Think of imperative as telling someone how to approach a problem and declarative as telling something what to accomplish. Declarative code is reusable and typically easier to understand. To avoid errors and move faster, the standard is moving toward a more declarative style. And this reliability is why CloudFormation uses declarative resource templates. But sometimes developers want to code imperatively. And this is what I love about AWS CDK. You don't have to choose. A lot of developers, perhaps even you, love imperative programming. It's taking infrastructure as code beyond YAML. And well, developers love to develop. We love code. We want the reliability of declarative resourcing with the experience of imperative resourcing. This is what CDK provides, the power to declare imperatively Well, that and so much more. As you might imagine, developers at AWS do plenty of provisioning, which can leave folks looking a little like this morose pug. And if you embrace continuous deployment, provisioning imperatively can quickly become a Sisyphean task. You've seen our architecture diagrams. AWS teams realized they needed a better solution. AWS CloudFormation is the best option to create and provision resources for highly reliable, highly scalable applications. But we wanted to make it even easier. AWS CDK takes all the power of CloudFormation and abstracts that resourcing further through the concept of constructs, while enabling you to work in the programming language with which you're already familiar. I mean, so long writing YAML, unless you like writing YAML.
Well, the AWS CDK is available in TypeScript, JavaScript, Python, Java, and C#. And Golang support is now available in developer preview. But it's not just the auto creation of complex YAML and JSON that makes the CDK an incredible abstraction and developer tool. With the CDK, you can use standard logic patterns that you're already familiar with, like if statements and for loops. You can model your application using object-oriented techniques. You can test your infrastructure code. You can package it into libraries. You can share those libraries with your colleagues or community. CDK essentially bridges the gap between application code and infrastructure code and helps you create a more holistic view of your application. We believe so strongly in the potential of CDK and the concept of constructs that we opened it up to the entire developer community to contribute and use their own CDKs. HashiCorp, for example, recently created the CDK for Terraform. And CDKates is the CDK for Kubernetes. It's a sandbox project in the CNCF that generates Kubernetes manifests. So in addition to supporting various languages, the CDK is centered around a concept called a construct, or the construct programming model, which is a way of composing an application from various abstractions. These abstractions are called constructs. And there are three levels of constructs. Underlying all these levels of constructs, all these abstractions layer, is a single resource, for example, an S3 bucket. Level one describes low-level constructs called CFN resources. These constructs directly represent the discrete resources that are available in AWS CloudFormation. For example, CFN bucket here represents an Amazon S3 bucket. And at this level, you have to configure all the different properties of that resource. But level two, or L2, constructs are available, they're higher level representations of those resources. And they come with default properties, boilerplate logic, and an intent-based API that's already been made for you. Developers don't need to know the underlying details of that resource and can instead work with these predefined intuitive methods. For example, the S3 bucket class has a number of methods and properties available to you out of the box. You can think of L2 as an abstraction of an API. And by that I mean you're still utilizing an API, but it's a higher level, more succinct interface than you'd get at L1. The highest level of abstraction in these constructs is what we call patterns. These represent common groupings of tasks in AWS services. And patterns don't just abstract a single resource, but instead multiple resources. An example of an abstracted pattern might be a full thumbnail image resizing service, where you can have this resizing architecture that sits on top of S3 and sits on top of Lambda, but it gives you this pattern across these different constructs. Another example might be a PubSub component, so that rather than having to stitch together multiple services like SNS and SQS, you'd get a PubSub construct that gives you that architecture in one library. One last example of an L3 construct would be one that launches an Amazon ECS service with a Fargate launch type. In just a few lines of code, this rather small class here creates an AWS CloudFormation template that has over 500 lines of YAML and produces more than 50 individual resources.
That's incredible. We recently launched Construct Hub as a way to more easily discover CDK construct libraries published by the open source community, AWS, and its partners. The CDKs on Construct Hub include the pattern constructs that generate CloudFormation templates, as well as CDK for Terraform and CDKates. At constructs.dev, you can filter for CDK resources by type, resource, publisher, or keyword. These assets are available to anyone, including those without an AWS account. You'll be able to find documentation and code samples in every CDK-supported language to more quickly provision infrastructure resources in the cloud. I mean, who doesn't love that? It's fantastic. Now, a few weeks ago, when we were chatting, you talked about productivity without compromise. I love that phrase, productivity without compromise. Tell me more about that.
Sure. It's common in developer tools to see productivity come at a cost. There's usually some kind of compromise you end up having to make somewhere along the way. There are three common problems that we often see, or common problems or compromises that we see when we use abstractions. You see abstraction penalties, abstraction leaks, or abstraction walls, and I'll cover each of these. An abstraction penalty could be, for example, the performance penalty that you'd see in an ORM, or an object relational mapping. The convenience of their ORM comes at the cost of performance. The abstraction penalty for this improved developer experience is the performance hit you get to your database queries. We talked earlier about Java and how Java introduced a trade-off between productivity and memory safety compared to C, and about how Rust improved on that by removing the penalty, by managing memory at compile time rather than at runtime. And it's this evolution of abstractions that enables developers to continue moving quickly and reliably. In the case of the CDK, it was important that every level of abstraction compile down to CloudFormation templates so that you avoid any kind of performance penalty. Now, the second common problem I see is leaks. And this is when the details of the lower level abstraction bleeds into or leaks into the higher levels of abstraction. Ideally, an abstraction should obfuscate the underlying details so that you don't know about them. An example of this might be Elastic Beanstalk in AWS. Elastic Beanstalk abstracts EC2 resources for providing a hosting experience, but in order to do so, it creates new roles in the customer's AWS account. This sort of byproduct isn't ideal, but it's sometimes necessary due to other constraints like security. The last penalty is the abstraction wall. This is where you can operate seamlessly with the abstraction until you hit the proverbial wall. And then you can go no further in using this abstraction because it doesn't support anything outside of that. Avoiding this is often solved by providing the ability to look under the hood or have access to the underlying code. If an abstracted service is extensible and you're able to continuously improve or add as needed, you can benefit from the abstraction without having to worry about these unexpected blockers. Now, the best abstractions avoid all three.
One of the things I've been struck by working at AWS is just how thoughtful engineers are about creating solutions. They don't just think about solving the problem right in front of them. I find that they consider the repercussions of those solutions as well. Not just immediate, but how is this going to function and scale in a year? 5 years, even a decade? How can this be extended or improved? AWS Amplify is an abstraction that I feel avoids all three of those abstraction penalties.
This morning, Werner announced AWS Amplify Studio, an exciting new feature set in AWS Amplify. Amplify Studio provides an acceleration tool for front-end app development. But before we dive into the new features, Emily, care to take us through a tour of AWS Amplify?
Yeah, I can surely do that. It doesn't get easier than Amplify. Designed for professional developers, Amplify generates production-ready AWS code as needed, removing that undifferentiated heavy lifting that takes up so much time in a developer's day. The first step in utilizing Amplify is to add data modeling. The default data type is string, but Amplify has built-in type inference to help make assumptions about data. It'll try to help you. For example, it'll try and, you know, help you use integer if you accidentally selected string for a field like age, let's say. In the case of multiple models, you can determine the relationship between data in the dropdown, whether it's one-to-one, one-to-many, many-to-many. In Amplify, the patterns of development you're already familiar with are the same. It's just that you don't have to write the code by hand. It's generated for you. When you make changes, you can kick off deployments to the staging environment. You can always see what's in progress by clicking the link on the upper right. Next, you'll set up authorization rules. My favorite part of Amplify is just how human-friendly it is. I find it's a little bit like coding in English, but production-grade AWS backends are generated for you. That's fantastic. Amplify creates a strongly typed API using GraphQL connected to a scalable DynamoDB database. You can set up full-text search using OpenSearch, along with conflict detection for offline and collaborative apps, all with the click of a button. I mean, come on, y'all, this is incredible. None of this is hidden from you. And in order to avoid abstraction walls, you have access to everything. One of the best ways to avoid abstraction walls is to create escape hatches or design a system to be layered and composable. This is the strategy the Amplify team took from the very beginning. Not just in the console, but also locally via the Amplify CLI. You'll answer a few questions to ensure Amplify tailors the application to your specific needs, some of those frameworks in JavaScript you mentioned earlier, and then boom, you have access to all the underlying code in a fraction of the time that it would have taken you to build out basic data models and CRUDL functionality by hand. Oh, one more thing. The Amplify CLI compiles down to CloudFormation resource templates, just like CDK. This makes Amplify extensible and ensures productivity without compromise by allowing you to override Amplify resources.
Should we show them what's new?
Yes.
All right. So Amplify Studio extends the functionality of Amplify to make front-end development a breeze. Whereas Amplify itself abstracts the generation of service components, Amplify Studio generates framework and UI components. Studio adds dozens of front-end components common to most applications, whether web or mobile. These could include, for example, common layouts like product views, often seen in e-commerce sites. Each component is customizable so that your site can be one of a kind. You can set up individual properties on each component, and there's a seamless integration between these UI components and the data model that already exists in Amplify. Amplify Studio will suggest potential data models within your application to link to each component. By the way, having clear naming in your application for data modeling will help you with the larger applications. In this example of a rental listing, you can see how the service allows you to dynamically concatenate so that the price of each listing is prefixed with the currency, and in this case, dollars. From there, you can determine the layout of a collection and customize how your users will view this information, as well as dynamically ensure that ensure which items will be shown in each collection. When you're done designing the layout of each component, you'll see the code snippets at the bottom of the page that you can import so that you can import new designs into your application. You can then pop over to your IDE, add a couple pieces of information. You'll then import home collection at the top of the file, and then render the collection. Amplify's staging environment allows you to preview the changes immediately. Now, one of the tools that we know AWS customers use a lot is Figma for prototyping, which is why Amplify Studio integrates with Figma. With this integration, designers and front-end developers are able to integrate their workflows seamlessly. So rather than having to start all over again in an antiquated analog handoff between prototyping and front-end development, the Figma integration enables a smooth transition between UX design and development. Within Figma, you'll be able to make iterative changes to each component, as well as add small design touches, in this case, a star rating. Once those changes are made, you'll sync the components, you'll pull down the latest changes, and then you can see your updates and staging within seconds, all without any code changes. I think Amplify Studio helps developers and designers work more seamlessly with each other without a lot of back and forth.
Whatever the implementation, an abstraction doesn't replace or displace developers or engineers of all types. It accelerates our work, applying known solutions to common challenges. This means that you can focus on the currently unknown solutions to less common challenges, the ones unique to your organization, industry, or discipline. We abstract the now so that you can focus on the next.
We hope you're excited about some of the innovations and releases that we've shared with you today. The developer community is really important to me and to AWS. As we journey forward in building even more abstractions, please join us on that journey and give us feedback along the way. We are committed to your productivity with no compromise. Anyway, thank you for joining us. Good evening, and enjoy the rest of reInvent.
Thank you.